multi-state federal litigation. That doesn't matter if you're talking about Virginia's version of the bill. This bill is also called the Elizabeth Smart Law, the Digital Blind Act Law, and the Human Trafficking Child Exploitation Prevention Act. What it does is it says going forward, all cell phone manufacturers and retailers, tablet and laptops are going to have to install filters that are custom designed that automatically block prostitution hubs, child pornography, revenge pornography, and obscenity as defined under the code right now. If the consumer is over 18 and wants to have access to that content, it's not a problem. They just have to show proof of ID, just like they have to show proof of ID at the gas station, have access to a Playboy. And they have to also pay any fee set by the retailer to deactivate the filter. And then also there's a nominal fee that will go back to the state to help offset the secondary harmful effects that content creates. And so basically the question presented by this bill is, it raises the question, why is it that a 12-year-old in the state of Virginia cannot go see an R-rated movie, they can't buy a Playboy from the gas station, but they can walk around with an X-rated theater in the form of a filterless iPhone sold through the Verizon store? It's a double standard under the code. It's clearly proliferating child exploitation. It's promoting human trafficking. It's victimizing children. It's eroding community standards of decency. And so in the instant case here, this is just a simple burden-shifting scenario. When anybody buys a product that distributes the internet or makes the content accessible, there's an automatic burden that's created. Either the group of consumers who want to avoid being exposed to child pornography, revenge pornography, prostitution hubs, and obscenity are going to have to take steps to modify the product to make it safer, jerry-rig it in some way, or we can shift that burden to the manufacturers and retailers to make the product safe already in the form that when it's sold. The group of consumers that want to access that unprotected, harmful stimuli, the burden can be shifted onto them to take the steps to a few nominal steps to be able to acquire that content. And so this is what the bill accomplishes. It's a very common sense burden shifting scenario. Right now, all the schools in Virginia have filters in place. The technology is there, but they're from third-party filters. And sometimes those filters block things they're not supposed to. Sometimes they don't block things they should. It shouldn't be on the schools that have to go out and try to figure out how to make the product safer. It should be on the manufacturers and retailers because they have the insider knowledge. And there's so much good law that we came up with through litigating this, such as, products that don't leave the instrumentality and control of the seller, manufacturer, help to higher standards of care and products liability. And it's, of course, made clear that filters in the Supreme Court in Ashcroft versus the ACLU has made crystal clear that filters are the least restrictive means. This bill is no different from the existing display statute, which all 50 states have at this time. That's a statute that simply says if you have a gas station or a newsstand in the state of Virginia, and you want to sell a sports magazine next to a hunting and fishing magazine, next to a Playboy and Hustler, you can do that. But the Playboy and Hustler have to go behind a blinder rack, some kind of opaque covering. They can only be accessible if the consumer is over 18, shows proof of ID, and then the retailer will deactivate them, allow them to have access to that. In the instant case here, if the content in the digital form was in its physical form in the gas station, if it would have to be put behind the physical blinder rack, and then, it is the case here, this bill would require that content be put behind the digital blinder act. But it is the case that sex trafficking has gone from the street corner to the smartphone. It is the case that this bill will do more to fight human trafficking than any other measure since the inception of the internet by just making it more inconvenient to acquire the content. There's many different aspects of the bill I could talk about in terms of how it impacts criminal justice, how it would help the state fulfill its compelling state interest set forth in the Supreme Court of Harris Theater. And so I can continue to go. I can leave it open for questions with you gentlemen.
I'm not sure
we'll
ask a question. Why is the state obscenity law not just covered this argument?
The code does cover it. Number one, the code would say that it's a crime for a retailer to distribute pornography to a minor. It also would say it's a crime right now to promote prostitution.
Right, so wouldn't the state of sending law allow you to get at the real troublemaker who is the producer of obscene material?
In the instant case here, the superseding cause is the explosion in human trafficking.
My question is, the bad guy in this player isn't isn't Qualcomm or Apple or that, the bad guy, they might be the vehicle the bad guy uses to commit wrongdoing, but the bad guy is the producer distributing the seed materials. We have an obscenity statute in Virginia. Why is nobody prosecuted under obscenity statute in Virginia?
Well, in the instant case here, without the cell phone, the terms of it at all.
That's not what I'm asking you. Right. I'm asking you is why aren't people prosecuted under the existing obscenity statute in Virginia?
In terms of why they're prosecuting, for example, someone who's creating pornography? Or someone
we have an obscenity statute in Virginia.
We do.
It gets at the actual producer distributor of the pornography.
Right.
Why aren't people just being prosecuted under that?
Because individuals can create, I said it, they can create torture webs for pornography websites. They're supposed to be prosecuted under child pornography, they're making it, but there's so many violations.
Okay, Virginia has 18.2374, says it shall be unlawful for any person knowingly to prepare any obscene item for the purpose of sale or distribution. Obscene is that using the same definition you're using in your statute.
Right.
So it's illegal in Virginia to prepare or distribute obscene material. So why not go after bad guys?
The state of Virginia has jurisdiction over those creating pornography in the state, for example. But it's still being
shadowed for distributing in the state too.
Well, basically, without the product that turns on and off, there's no access to prostitution of it. There's no access to this criminalized illegal content.
Well, I mean, again, that's not my question. There was prostitution long before cell phones existed.
Right.
I agree. Here's what I totally agree with you. Human trafficking is a massive problem. Totally agree with you. And I totally agree that the pervasiveness of obscene materials plays some role in many ills in our society, including not limited human trafficking. I totally agree with that. The question to me is, what's the best avenue to get at it? The answer to why we don't prosecute obscenity statutes is because it's clearly unconstitutional. And nobody's gonna prosecute under that. So, but I'm not sure how we get around that question by going at someone who's just selling a phone or a refrigerator that connects to the internet.
In the instant case here, we're not trying to hurt the tech companies. We should call this bill the Pro-Tech New Revenue Stream Act. That's what we should call it. Because what the bill does is this is a common sense version. It's a perfect use of the state legislature. You don't have to be a lawyer to realize that this bill is going to protect children and help reduce crime and help proliferate the compelling state interest. You don't have to be a tech expert to know how this works. The legislature is just going to do what they do in the case with strip clubs. So, like, for example, if someone wants to build a strip club in the city, the legislature can say, look, the Supreme Court's already found there's secondary harmful effects of this content. It's already established. It's not even going to have to prove it.
Right, so what my question is to you is, we don't punish the guy who builds the road that goes to the strip club that's illegal. We punish the illegal strip club.
Right. In the instant case, we're just engaging. I'm asking the legislature to engage in the use of the time, place, and... Okay, I'm sorry.
My question I'm trying to get at is,
yes.
Again, I've agreed with you on, at least on some level, the problem. Okay. What I'm trying to figure out is why your solution to the problem isn't going at the wrongdoer, but is going at the person who's just selling the product, and then the wrongdoer is manipulating for their advantage. Again, we don't punish the guy who builds the road, we punish the strip club. So why not beef up our law that says if you produce these materials and you make them accessible to children underage, you go to jail for the rest of your life? Why not just say that?
Well, the people making it accessible to children underage are the sellers of the product that's distributing it. It's not the porn content creator, it's not the website maker. They're not going out and giving the websites to children. Well, I mean, they definitely do a good job of roping them in, but in the instant case,
right, but, well, why not? If you can put a filter on the phone, why not put a filter at the website level? It says it's illegal to have a website in Virginia that has any obscene material without age verification software on it, and if you do, you go to jail for the rest of your life.
It's a great question. It's called Child Online Privacy Protection Act. It's called COPA, which was a case that it was a bill introduced by Senator Markey. It was a bill that was struck down by the Supreme Court because the Supreme Court found through a congressional inquiry that filters are the least restrictive means, and that the United States only has jurisdiction over porn content created within the United States. Plus, there was copyright violations by going to individual websites that asked them to modify their website in some way to have age verification. So that's already been litigated. It was the ACLU who recommended it. Filters are the least restrictive means, and the Supreme Court relying on the Ginsburg case.
So none of that answered my question.
Well, I appreciate it.
Okay. Anybody else have any questions for this witness? All right, anybody else here to speak to the bill? And we're going to speak in opposition to the bill. Come on up, introduce yourself, and offer your testimony.
The incidents of human trafficking to protect children. We strongly share those goals and our values. As drafted, however, this legislation is built on blocking and filtering content on the devices on the internet. First, I want to say that internet companies work very hard to block all child pornography that users attempt to access or send across their networks. This is a complex process that involves filtering images identified by the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children. Additionally, Virginia internet service providers have had a strong partnership with the Attorney General's Computer Crimes Division for many years to go after those engaging in criminal activity over our networks. Internet companies also offer customers ways to block content at little or no cost at their option. Additionally, there are many kinds of third-party software, apps, and services that seek to block content for consumers. However, these software and services are not 100% accurate and can be both under-inclusive, missing content that some would argue should be filtered, and over-inclusive, filtering out content that may be legitimate, educational, and even important to a user. Consumers can determine their own risk tolerance in this regard and choose the filters that work best for them, recognizing the strengths and deficiencies of the various products and services on the market. Many of these are actually customizable settings depending on the ages of the kids and the needs of others in the family or the purchaser. The fact remains, however, that network and device providers do not have the capability to identify, block, and filter content across thousands or millions of content platforms, including content provided through third-party apps on the devices. Even if it were possible to do so, where and how content is accessed changes rapidly. And what is there today will certainly be elsewhere tomorrow. Tying this legislation to obscenity likewise is problematic, as the chairman observed. We do not believe technology businesses are equipped, nor do we believe it is appropriate for them to determine what is and what is not obscene given local community standards and other factors. Taking 5 days to correct any errors they may make also is not practical to a business crisis. We also are not sure how companies will be able to determine Virginia-bound devices to ensure they are modified as mandated by this legislation as they enter streams of commerce from various warehouses, storage facilities, and delivery mechanisms. The chairman observed the increasing prevalence of Internet of Things devices. You're not just talking about tablets and phones in this context. We're talking about appliances. We're talking about refrigerators. We're talking about ever-increasing amount of devices. Finally, we believe the user registration and fee requirement imposed by this legislation is likely to generate First Amendment challenges. We respectfully request that you not approve this bill and continue instead to build on the many important, positive, and effective bipartisan efforts this legislature has adopted over the past many years in combating, reducing, and punishing child pornography and human trafficking-related activities throughout the Commonwealth. Thank you, Mr. Chance.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is Dave Richholmer with CenturyLink. We're a telecom provider of both voice data and residential broadband service throughout the world, and also here in most of Western Virginia and Southwest Virginia. Just joining the comments of Mr. Levy on all of his points, and just a point I think I want to make is we do lots of things great as a telecom company. I don't think you want your companies in the business of deciding what the proper content is that you should be seeing. So.
But what if you... What obligation do you think you have if you literally know something illegal is being communicated through your services? Do you have any responsibility under state or federal law?
I'm sure we do. I have to check on what the answer is, but I'm sure there are some limits as to what things we are not allowed to have happen over our networks. I'm sure there's criminal activity that we're not allowed. We know about it. We would have to stop it. That's an interesting question. I don't know the answer exactly, but I will definitely find that out.
I mean, one of the dilemmas you have with a bill like this is obscenity is already illegal in Virginia. It's already defined. I'm assuming, I mean, the statute hasn't been touched since 1975. I'm assuming it's never been prosecuted because it's clearly unconstitutional. So it's either already illegal, and therefore you don't need it, or it's legal, and we're asking you to regulate legal stuff. But there's, of course, a lot of illegal activity that does take place on the internet. In fact, there's new technologies created so that people can do illegal things. I mean, there's a reason why Bitcoin got super popular when it did. Okay,
thank you.
All right, next up.
Mr. Chairman and members of the subcommittee, Brittany West on behalf of the Entertainment Software Association representing companies that publish computer and video games. For the reasons so eloquently stated by Mr. Levy, we also oppose
this bill. All right, thanks. Next.
Mr. Chairman, Jerry Block on behalf of Virginia Retail Federation, and we also oppose this legislation based on the obvious evidence that has been presented here today by previous speakers. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, Jeff Merriman with Verizon, and we support the comments of Mr. Levy, and we also oppose this.
Do you believe that Verizon currently has any legal or regulatory, state or federal obligations to interfere with, report any illegal activity happening on Verizon lines?
I don't know the answer definitively, but I know that we are proactive and working against, certainly, like child pornography, for example. But like Mr. Shulman, I need to verify that, for sure.
We hear a lot, and we heard a lot several years ago, especially about the providers working with the federal government, either voluntarily or not voluntarily, and information when from a terrorism prevention standpoint. I just don't know on these issues. Okay, thanks.
Hi, Mr. Chairman, Keith Martin, the Virginia Chamber of Commerce. For the same reasons as the previous speaker, we also oppose.
All right, thanks.
Okay, so the question presented is whether the devices are dangerous and defective in the current form. The fact that they are third-party filtering is an admission of guilt that the products are dangerous and defective. There should be a third party who doesn't have insider knowledge modifying these companies' products to make them safer. They have the insider knowledge and can create their own custom-designed filters to send out. And this is not going to change the internet. It's just going to block this unprotected, harmful content by default. They already sell their products with parental controls. We're just basically asking them to sell it activated and withhold the password. They can charge a fee to remove it as well, so it actually fulfills the business judgment rule. The idea that you asked if they have a duty, any duties, and they absolutely have a ton of legal duties. One of the duties is they have a duty under the federal law and most state laws to report certain content. The arguments they just made were,
what state law in Virginia applies to that?
There's a lot of state laws that have them. I believe there is.
I'm gonna look it up while we're sitting here.
I think I've got it on my laptop.
Why don't you go grab it?
You know that?
Yeah, that'd be good.
Yes, sir.
Can we finish this point? Is that okay, or do we need to stop right now?
And now it doesn't mean what it used to mean, where it was just some website somewhere with information fairly static, and we were able to access that and retrieve that information. There is a whole series of connectivities and communications and data points. So how do you deal with, like, my refrigerator? It literally connects to the internet, makes internet content available. How do you deal with the modern proliferation of the internet of things? Cars that connect to the internet. I mean, everything's connected. We've got pens that connect to the internet.
Sure. Well, there's probably very few questions that the chairman could have thrown at me that I would have felt I maybe had some confidence in answering. But if your refrigerator has the ability to deliver pornography into your kitchen, then it should have a blocking device on it. It should be covered as devices would be in this. This bill.
I mean, I think any device which can connect to the internet by sending information and receiving information could be configured in such a way that it could receive obscene information or a Craigslist posting where they're trying to human traffic or that kind of thing. And so, I mean, we would get way down to the technical weeds on how to implement the statute. But one of the concerns I have is if we could narrow it down to, like, this is the device that's causing the problem, and this is how industry is manipulating us and making money off of us, that would be something we maybe could get to. It gets a little tricky, again, when we just talk about something that can receive information from the internet. And even, I don't think you or I are the experts on how the internet works. I know I'm wrong.
Accessing the websites that are objectionable and to provide obscene material would seem to kind of isolate a portion of the activity that's on the internet that we're trying to address.
Does the bill, so one of the problems I understand is with human trafficking and prostitution is there are websites that may not contain obscene content, but are selling obscene content. So there's websites where you can go, I think, acquire someone in human trafficking, for example, where they're literally selling people. Does your statute, does it get to that, or is it just like the visually obscene materials?
I'm glad to say I don't have a lot of specific knowledge of that, but I did have to go to a mom in the building yesterday, which is one of the women featured in the movie I Am, Jane Doe, talking about her daughter who had been kidnapped. So I'll just relate a little bit of the personal experience that she had to me, and perhaps speak to that. Her daughter had a tattoo that she recognized as being posted on, I think, that page. So the face wasn't there, so I'm going to approach actual identification, but she could see her child. And even after she pursued with this website, to having those pictures removed, they resisted her. They stayed up for weeks and weeks until, I'm not sure who intervened. But so to answer your question, I would say most of the advertising that is done for promotion and child pornography advertises a product, and that's part of the obscene material, that's part of how this would be useful in instructing those.
Well, I mean, a picture, a non-obscene picture, but trying to like sell a child in human trafficking wouldn't fit with the definition of obscene materials. I think it would fit into your definition on line 22 of any website that facilitates the commission of these offenses. I think that's what that's getting at.
Thank you for
I'm not, again, these are sort of in the weeds technical questions of how you identify like a Craigslist. We know some websites like backpage.com, as I think it was in your materials, appears to exist for this purpose. There are others that, you know, eBay, someone could go on and try to use the eBay service to sell something. Were you able to find?
Yes, sir.
Answer your telephone,
yes, sir. So there's US code 2258A.
How's that about Virginia?
The duty to report in terms of Virginia, again, there's a lot of, most of the states have the same concurrent bill. In the instant case here, I don't see it readily available in terms of Virginia duty to report for the local retailers, but the local retailers are subject to that federal statute. So the states that do have that literally just quote the federal statute basically and say they have
what
a duty to
report. Statute say?
It's duty to report.
Sorry.
It's 20. It's 18 USC 2258 duty to report in general. Whoever will engage in providing electronic communication service or remote communication service to the public through facility or means of interstate or foreign commerce obtains actual knowledge of any facts or circumstances described in paragraph 2 shall as soon as possible A, provide to the cyber tip line or the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children or successor to the cyber tip line operation. It just goes on, and it includes tons of different.
You say 2258?
Yeah, 2258A.
I'm looking at it and it doesn't look like
it. Content of the report.
It's a child abuse statute. This is reporting child abuse. Am I 18 USC 2258?
2258A.
Okay. All right. Okay.
I'm not a subject matter expert on this, but the question presented is whether or not the product in its current condition is dangerous and defective, and whether or not the state would benefit everyone, and whether everyone would win if prostitution hubs, child pornography, revenge pornography, obscenity were blocked by default. There's no question whether the tech companies have a duty to remove child pornography when they discover it and report it. I don't have that statute readily available. There's also no question that revenge pornography is victimizing citizens who are living in the state of Virginia. And what this bill would do is it would take revenge pornography images and not delete them, and it wouldn't delete backpage.com, and it wouldn't delete pornhub.com, but it would put it behind the blinder rack, and it would actually allow the tech companies to comply with a federal statute called the Lanham Act, which is a statute that says you can't engage in false advertising. All of these companies market their products as family-friendly, and they're just simply not. And again, this is not about adults and their desire to look at pornography. This is about blocking the content by default and letting consumers have the fundamental freedom of free choice to choose to opt in instead of opting everyone in and making them fend for themselves. You know, if they stumble upon child pornography, they can be subject to crushing criminal liability. If they, you know, it's almost unavoidable how much pornography is on these products. And it's causing children to sexually suck down. We have 33,000 testimonies from Fight the New Drug, minors who were injured. We have so much testimony from Johns who just say, you know, the problem is it's just too easy to commit these crimes. It's right there. So in the instant case here, we're just basically saying that this content, this unprotected, harmful speech, should be zoned by these companies. They can easily create a reporting website and mechanism. This bill will not block Facebook, YouTube, or Twitter because they have their own mechanism to deactivate, they have their own reporting mechanism. Sorry. Okay, I'm sorry.
Any other questions? All right. You good? You want another last word?
One last word. That is, you know, I tell this to federal judges all the time. I just say, Your Honor, some doors in life are better left unopened. We're just asking the state legislature to just close the door on that. Make it to where the products are sold clean. We're not trying to hurt the tech companies. We like technology.
We're just asking that they scale back the dark side of technology by filtering that content, prostitution of child pornography, revenge pornography, and it will really help the public health.
All right. Bill, have we adopted all those amendments? Did we adopt them?
Yes, we did.
Okay, so the amendments we adopted were all four on that sheet that you handed out. So the delay enactment clause and only apply to sales after that date. And has the definition of obscene content inserted and deleted or in writing. All right, Bill's for the subcommittee. We have a motion? All right, thank you, sir.